you know, with any shape or form. That is more a question of trying to make you guys familiar with the kind of things that the self and others get involved with regards to the underwater world, particularly. Illustrative only. It's more of like a dessert. Just to give you an indication of what the world of sonar is all about, where multiple scattering might come into play. And the title kind of implies that multiple scattering does occur quite a lot in these problems. And they do, and I'm going to give you a little bit of an illustration on that, hopefully. So without further ado, I'll crack on, and feel free to stop me if you get bored or if there's anything you want to clarify. As I say, this is illustration in the main. It's not mathematical, rigorous, or there'll be a few equations in there, but not very many. And the other thing I'll try and point out is that there are a few things that still need to be resolved in the world of sonar. Despite the fact that being what's regarded as a mature topic, going back over 100 years now, there are still things to be done, and with new technologies and new concepts coming to the fore, the mathematical methods are going to be core to its progression. So, just a brief set of context. I'm going to give you an overview of sonar. So you'll all be experts in the next few minutes, or at least able to understand sonar as well as I do, which is, limited. I'll give you an explanation as to why the UK, particularly, is interested in sonar technology. And when it comes to the aspects of this workshop, I'll give a little bit of indication where multiple scattering phenomena are core to some of these aspects, in particular, things like acoustic materials, which are central to sonar systems and design. And I'll also get I'll illustrate one or two other things. There's a little bit about a bio-inspired designs and things. So here we go. And I'll finish off with some final comments, which may or may not be that. The UK is we're an island nation. A lot of our trade is through the sea. We've got responsibilities for oil and gas and everything else. And also, from the point of view of sonar, particularly with regards to Thales and others, our defence systems are largely submarine-based, strategic ones. So sonar is particularly important to in this world. You're all going to become experts in a minute. Passive sonar is when you listen out to something. It's basically things like the sound radio vessels, and in the context of submarines, you're listening out for the sounds and trying to make sense of what these are. So it's intrinsically covert, and so submarines can go around and listen to various things, and you can figure out what's going on. You can estimate what the sound is classifying, giving you some indication of what's out there. But you also, as well as detecting submarines and ships, they're useful for monitoring particularly mammal life, marine life, but also things like other things, seismic sources, nuclear test ban treaties, and that sort of thing. So now you're all expert on that. Practice sonar is the sort of thing you hear in the films, where you basically send out sound and you listen for the echoes. It's a bit like what bats do and dolphins do in particular, and some of the animals. And so you can get direct estimates from the range, and you can listen out for the echoes and sort of things like that. And these are useful for things like finding submarines or also mines and bottom, and also things like aircraft wreckage and all sorts of stuff, oil and gas and fish finding. But also, interestingly enough, for things like the in the climate change world, people send out sound over very, very, very old distances, and they can measure the gross temperature of the sea, because the sound propagation is governed by the temperature, so you can get some indication of that kind of thing as well. So there's a number of applications for these kinds of technologies. And typical sonars come in all shapes of flat sizes. It's what we call the large aperture arrays. You can see on the top there's a submarine, the big rubbery thing to the side is a sonar. It's also one at the front. But also ships have got them that are at the back and the front. Sometimes they have them towed along, which gives them greater aperture, which is a useful thing to have. But also, you also have things hanging off the back of ships, like this kind of yellow thing in the bottom right, which is what's called a variable depth sonar that produces lots of sound. And it's got these high ring black projectors, which I'll talk about a little bit more in due course. And also other things. So things like finding objects in the bottom of the sea with very high frequency synthetic aperture and so on. Anyway, so we're all expert now in sonar waves. And these are the kind of challenges we have to worry about. We have to worry particularly about that bloke on the top right there in his little plastic bubble, the baldy guy. He's been a bit naughty recently, and so we need to make sure that I hope you recognize him. he's been of a particular importance to NATO and so on. So we're looking for things like operating in various types of waters. We want better resolution, better performance, better range, high frequency, all these various things. Everything has to be cheap as usual, and small, ideally, and with ever increasingly more sophisticated types of various things, and modular and all these great things. And at the end of the day, I'll put a little bit to talk about how, in some respects, bioinspired designs can help us with some of these things and some of these scattering effects associated with that. Just for the lesson, one of the things, of course, you remember is you've got lots and lots and lots of sensors on these things, and you've got the very large apertures, and just to illustrate this, you've got a big thing platform. The submarine was looking at these various sensors all over the place, and to quote Joe Starling, quantities one quality of its own. Usually what happens is you can vary those sensors, they don't have to be that precise, but we've got so many of them working in concert that all helps the performance. So, anyway, right. In terms of the sound propagating under the, in the ocean, you'll find that it propagates in different ways, in different schemes, depending on the types of environment, and also what's called the sound speed profile. In other words, you go down through the sound channel that you're watching, the sound speed varies as a function of temperature and pressure and so on, and that then just refracts the sound and makes it all go in different. Modes in the particularly in deep water, you get upward refraction, which I'll show in a moment, and also in shallow waters, there's bouncing all over the place from the surface and the bottom, and also from the objects themselves. And these are the kind of things that you might see. You've got on the bottom, on the left side, you've got these what are called conversion zones where the sound all comes together. And multiply reflects, and so the multiple scattering in that sense from the different types of surface wave conditions, and you can see that the sound kind of bends upwards in these contexts, and you've got sort of different, depending on different environmental conditions, you get different sorts of multiple scattering effects. And these then are all governed by the sea state, how rough the sea is. and how that the sort of length scales associated with that, and how that compares with the actual wave the frequencies of the wavelength that you that the sound has. So the kind of things that one from a multiple scattering point of view, you've got multiple objects, multiple boundaries, different kinds of absorption, different kinds of propagation, varying time and space. We've got, I'd say, complicated frequency dependence, because sometimes the bottom might be like mud, so that have a different sort of frequency response to, say, rock and so on. The other thing is that in the context of propagation, unlike some multiple scattering problems, you've got very, very many wavelengths and a variety of propagation conditions. So that's a kind of slightly unusual kind of multiple scattering problem. It has to be said that acousticians and particularly underwater people have been trying to wrestle with these things, and they, you know, they've got a reasonable handle on that. But where it becomes more problematic, which I haven't started directly, is when you're looking at three-dimensional effects. The modelling that people tend to normally do is two-dimensional, in the way that I kind of showed you earlier on. And they're looking at sort of ray-type or iconal-type modelling capabilities, although they do take full wavelengths, full wavelength type analysis, like normal models and some of them. But again, these are multiple scattering effects in some form or other. And in the context of three-dimensional propagation, which is what people have now become more interested in the quantitative sonar, because of various coastal effects and various other things, that becomes more of an issue. So there may be some aspects of multiple scattering theory that could be particularly relevant to this kind of problem. A similar sort of thing, as I say, is what design calibration and testing, and this is a bit more mundane, as it were, but basically it's kind of related insofar as what you're actually trying to do is test your devices in some kind of conditions that you can control. And in this instance, you're sending up sound and you're looking at how it reflects from the object, or how the object might respond, like a sensor or an array or something of that sort. And in that instance there, you've got multiple reflections from the tank, although you might put anechoic lining. This is a picture of a typical sort of tank. And then the thing on the top right is that it's a pressure type tank. In fact, that's sort of in National Physical Laboratory, where my mate Steve Robinson is in charge of that. And in fact, I helped get that from the Americans when I was in the NED. And in fact, they have a little cake and a selection type. But basically, you've got these various kind of tanks where you can vary not only the frequency and the sound, but also in the context of the tank on the top right, you can vary the pressure, you can make it simulate what it's like in deep water, and also you can vary the temperature. So these are the kind of things that one might be interested in with regards to how your sonar system might respond. And in terms of the multiple scattering issues, you've got, although you've got anechoic lining, there'll still be multiple reflections. And in terms of the transit times and that sort of thing. And it's a kind of, it's a multiple scattering problem, but it's one that's perhaps it's very specific. But it's kind of related to the previous one, the kind of propagation. You've got essentially reflections from various angles coming in and different sorts of propagation. And there are ways by which one can try and analyze these things, particularly with regards to time varying things. So you send out a signal and then you gate it, as it were, such that you kind of minimize the effects of further reflections. But if one wants to do a more exact kind of calibration of that, or you want to look at lower frequencies, which the tank wouldn't normally allow you to, you can can do various techniques to pick up putting series and getting those capture. This is a kind of logarithm of the inverse of a Fourier transform. You can find all these techniques out. And these are the kind of things that are being done for those sort of problems. And they're mainly experimental laboratory sort of techniques. But there may well be multiple scattering, particularly with regards to few body scattering events that one can maybe then include in these things or refine them essentially. So, as I say, in terms of, it's a little bit like the previous one, but you've got objects and boundaries varying in space. Not that many wavelengths, unlike the propagation ones. So in that regard, it's a different type of problem. There are short time intervals, because essentially, the longer you examine or you look at the time series, the more reflections from various objects you don't have to deal with. And as I say, it tends to be more difficult to roll things, so the wavelengths start becoming comparable to the overall dimensions of your time itself. So these are the kind of things that one might want to try and address, perhaps in some kind of multiple scattering kind of sense. Where multiple scattering in the grand scheme of things is more kind of familiar to the kind of things that you guys will be looking at is in the context of acoustic materials. As you might already know, sometimes submarines, certainly more advanced nations and navies, they kind of get covered in these kind of what's called acoustic tiles and claddings. And you can see on the top right there's a picture of an American submarine where some of the tiles have fallen off, which is what which can happen in some instances. And with the eye of faith, you can just about see down here. The top lid there, the lid comes off of those tiles. And so you can see it's basically just a hole, it's like a big rubbery mat with lots of holes in that have got acoustic characters. These are what you call macrovoided, large monocytoided structures. And they tend to be regular materials in terms of arrangements, but they also exhibit sort of depth and temperature dependence. And that's where the bulk of the interest, particularly from plants of sonar, lies. Although the acoustic aspects and multiple scattering have a significant bearing on the performance, of course. Other ones that one might consider are what's called these sort of random materials, like you can see this, like it's almost like the kind of thing that when my son was very young, he used to jump into these lots of little balls and stuff like that. But it's actually microspheres in a matrix or forms. And these are the kind of things that you basically use to develop or to tailor your materials, such as you've got a high absorption or good reflection, or these various characteristic properties that you would like to have your materials to provide. And so these things are more called microspheres. These are kind of little plastic spheres that sometimes are hollow or sometimes got softer material inside with matters and so on. And these are used within a sort of matrix to provide a kind of bulk effect of material which has useful acoustic behavior. This is something you probably already know, but this is basically looking at a multi-layered material where you've got sound coming in and being reflected back, or alternatively being transmitted. And so you look at things like the echo reduction and transmission loss that sound goes through and so on. And sometimes you might want it to be perfectly reflecting, in which case you want the reception to be very strong and the transmission very low, or alternatively might be the opposite. And these various things, and so I'll talk a little bit more about that. These tend to be, in the very simplest context, to be basically dependent on the elastic properties of materials, so the basic density, its effective sound speeds, shear speeds, as well as compressional speeds, which is an elastic material as opposed to, or this elastic material anyway, as opposed to a fluid. And you assign these things like the kind of impedance, and the impedance is basically the kind of product of the density in terms of the specific sound space that And that might, you might want that to be very similar to that of water, or you want to make it distinct from that of water in some shape or form. And then allow you to tailor the field in various ways around the submarine or the ship, or the ship or the acoustic anchor, whether it's along that way. You're considering. In some instances, particularly with regards to absorption, where you want to basically want that material to dissipate the sound in terms of heat and so on, you'd like that impedance to be very close to that water so the energy gets in and then the sound gets dissipated by scattering around in the hot material. And as I say, you can have several layers, and it's basically with a reasonable level of confidence, you can basically regard them as distinct layers and then end up with a kind of simple matrix kind of equation to effectively derive the acoustic characters of the entire sandwich, multiple sandwich. And in terms of the mathematical modelling, in some respects, there are instances of multiple scattering theory involved in this, quite sophisticated as current systems are. Essentially, you're trying to effectively design or derive the effective medium of the book medium, recognizing that actual layer is made of multiple scatters that might be in a regular arrangement or in some kind of irregular arrangement. And so you then try to sort of map that onto an effective medium where you can derive the effective acoustic behavior of that overall system in a way that you can then tailor or design or extending make use of such that high absorption or it's got a particular frequency dependence that's useful. But also, as I said before, because you're looking at sonar, the kind of things that one might be considering are things like the temperature and also the pressure, particularly the pressure. Because if you've got these macrovoids, you've got the recorders and so on, these then can be compressed as things go deep. And so you get more complicated things like happening where essentially the contact with the walls get distorted and so on. And there's a whole range of different things that one might try and do. So, from the point of view of multiple scattering theory, the approach that most sonar people up to now have been doing is that you kind of get effectively an effective medium kind of model, but the main emphasis is to looking at how the pressure behavior is affects models. And that is then examined in the in kind of material type models where you've got various ways by which you can account for the variation of the voids and their behavior under bulk hydrostatic pressure. And as I say, this is a kind of diagram symbol. You basically look at a kind of material, you've got essentially a large region where you've got these various individual scatters and you can. You've got essentially the bulk material properties for the matrix, but you've also got properties for the various little scatters. And then from that, you're then trying to figure out what that would effectively be like if it was a uniform material. And the kind of ways that one does that is that you look at, in the simplest way, is you try and look at the scattering from a single, in the context of an object embedded in a material. Like an elastic material or the surface material. You then try and figure out what that scattering might be in terms of the sort of spherical waves there from an incident wave. And so you've got compression and shear because you've got an elastic material. And then from that, then you could work out the various amplitudes for the scattered field and then try to then infer from that what would that be if it was a uniform type sort of material. And so you make the assumption, this is the thing, you start off with a single type approximation, at least at the lowest level of approximation. And then you assume that the scattering from those particles are very small compared to the rest of it. Some of them are like a weak scattering instance. So the basic overall scattering is essentially a non-sample of the individual scatters. And then so you can you can play various games like that and kind of improve to various levels of approximation. Some aspects of the multiple scattering theory, but you then essentially equate that to various to your parameters and such that you then derive the effective medium model that way. And in the context of things like microspheres and so on, which are kind of randomly distributed in a matrix, you can get reasonably good results, at least in the limits where you've got very small numbers of these things compared to the overall medium. And you can see the transmission loss and drop down. Then it's other aspects you change the bulk material and how that then varies with regards to the reflecting medium and how that then relates to the acoustic quantities that you've computed. And it's hard to put to make a judgment as to whether that's a good agreement by doing it, but in essence, for most things, when you get that. Within a 10%, 20% of that thing. If you get broadly the behavior, you can see on the bottom right, you've got these kind of oscillations at the very low frequencies. That's kind of, it's the kind of thing you'd like to show that some aspects of the physics are broadly there. And you should hope you should get that right because when you've got very low frequencies, very long wavelengths, then the weak scattering approximation becomes reasonably good. And again, you can see this is a comparison between the model and the measurement, and that looks at different depths as well, because as I said before, one of the key things that a lot of people have been looking at, particularly in the world of sonar, although you've got kind of a basic model which basically provides the essential bulk material properties from a kind of acoustic point of view, it's got multiple scattering, albeit but weak multiple scattering. You're also concerned, particularly with regards to the depth effects, because essentially you want your system to work when the sun goes down or whatever it is. There's been quite a lot of emphasis on refining the models from that perspective, as opposed to introducing more and more sophisticated models. Terms and so on. And this is another one, which is syntactic acoustic damping material, which is what the Americans have developed. You can buy this stuff now. It's called SADM, and it's not to do with anything you're laughing or anything like that, but it's to do with syntactic material, which is what this thing is. So it's a kind of rubbery. Loaded with lead. You might not want to be lead's becoming more of an issue, so they use probably metal, heavy metal. Although there's been quite a lot of depleted uranium around, people sometimes do think about using like heavy metal. You want to have something that's basically kind of very massive, but in a rubbery thing. So it's basically these little objects kind of resonate at different frequencies, and that then provides you with some kind of behavior which you can exploit, particularly with regards to absorption. So, in other words, you've got a distribution of these scatters within a kind of material that's like a kind of form or a rigid form. You can see that this is really not. You really ought not to work with a weak scattering approach. But with the gross assumption, you've got spherical scattering and weak scattering, and a layered sphere is essentially like a little rubbery sphere with a lead insert inside of it, or something like that. And you can make some gross assumptions about masses to the size distribution. You can work out an effect medium as you can before. And the prediction on the right, it doesn't look that bad, at least in some respects, with a bit of luck. But strictly speaking, it's a moot point whether this is good agreement or not, because essentially the material is so good at absorbing the signals that it's very difficult to actually derive meaningful data when you put very, very high losses on the right. But anyway, the point I'm making is that if one wants to try to refine it, you might have to then consider, rather than the spherical scattering, you need to follow the little prolate spheroid types. Objects of various sizes and different aspect ratios with material inside. And because essentially these are now have got that kind of sense, as it were, that direction, you then have to look at various orientations. And then, and there have been people looking at that, I think, to some extent, but I'm not so sure how well these things work as well. But that would be the way that one would try to deal with these sort of things. One of the things that engineers that join us always find, particularly young ones, they're all bright-eyed, pushing to them, they're all very good at things like finite element analysis, and they have to try and deal with things in randomized media. They get the sense how do you do finite element model of a thing that's all randomly oriented? And you can, but you need a very sophisticated sort of system. So we're really needing sort of models that allow us then to understand the relative behavior of these things, and particularly with regards to things that are not quite random, because that's the kind of thing people are now interested in. Don't necessarily have to be fully random. There may be some extra benefits in having them aligned in a certain way. So, in the context of multiple scattering, there'll be more complicated configurations I will try to allude to. You've got non-spherical scatterers, like the spherical and sort of complicated orientations, macrovoids, and also microvoids, the combinations. So you've got essentially large voids and small voids and so on. And the thing on the top right, that's the kind of Saturn material. It's the form of the dark, rubbery lead stuff. And you can see how that's been kind of random. It's so orientated and so on. So you need to look at that sort of thing. But also there's been quite a big, I'm sure some of you are very much aware, but there's been quite a big development in what's called metamaterials. And you might argue that we've been looking at net materials. The macrovoids are kind of like a net material, but not that sexy as the kind of things that come forward. But these are kind of like things we've got very, very interesting effects, using subwavelength resonators in some kind of what I call cascade, in some kind of configuration. And so you get strong interaction effects which improve the overall performance. But there might be some areas where you want to have random configurations for broadening the bandwidth, because clearly something that works at 500 Hz but 1 to 505 Hz isn't very useful in terms of the grand scheme of things. For some, something that operates with a much better frequency range, at least effectively. So the kind of things that one might be looking at are things like not only these kind of metamaterials, but also how they might be then randomized in some shape or form. So multiple scattering that can affect, they can embed the effect of metamaterial type phenomena, which is localized to the kind of unit cell, but then also to improve the overall bulk materials that might be randomized or some kind of configuration that's useful for the overall dynamics and performance. That's the kind of thing you might want to find in the multiple scattering theory to address. There are things like the porous materials. Some of you may not may be aware that porous materials have some interesting behavior, particularly with regard to things like biomaterials, we've got potentially different types of fluid flow within the porous at different speeds and so on. And those can then be used in these various materials and associate some that will give you extra benefits in different frequency regimes. And also, going back to my point about the pressure, there's always concern about the fact that, you know, as you go down, things get squashed and hopefully not submarine or deep inside, but you know, the various cladding of materials. And there may be some means by which you can use these lightweight forms that come to the fore, a bit more resilient for the underwater application. So these are the kind of things that I think multiple scanning theories can be, taking account of and looking at how that might be used for some applications. Going over quickly on, I talked about a little bit about advanced transmitters. But one of these are actually things that you deploy from a ship and then at different depths and then send out the sound in all directions and listen for the echoes. And the kind of things that looks like car tires. These are actually large piezoelectric cylinders that then oscillate at very high power. They have different behaviors. And because essentially you've got essentially like a kind of ring, they're topologically different from this kind of sphere. And I like to say it sound a little bit like an acoustician. And the consequence of that is that you can get more than one mode that these things behave and resonate very much like. And so you can get what you call a broad bandwidth, in other words, it operates at something like well over an octave, so it's like 2 kilohertz, 2 kilohertz, 4, and so on. And these are quite useful because then you can send out signals of quite a different character, and then when you get the echoes back, you can then make sense of them and understand it for a much better way. But the kind of thing that the risk is having a mess. I bet they think of nested array of things from this far, and it's pretty obvious, in actual fact, what you do is you put two different sizes of devices within this kind of column. But the benefit of that is that essentially you've got a kind of multi-mode effect where you basically broaden the bandwidth. So you get, instead of just one octave, you get up to three octaves. And in fact, Gordon says you shouldn't be able to get more than a third of an octave business, so that's kind of text. This is 15 years ago, not sure, it's the same effect or something. But my system actually produces sound over nearly 10 times as much as that. So I'm quite pleased with this kind of idea. But one of the things is the fact that what are called the woofers, which are the large rings, and the key is the inside to rip off high sound jargon. These things interact in a very interesting way, such that one of the things that's very useful is that you want to make sure that your system can operate at low frequencies. And the tutors within inside the woofers extract what's called a kind of organ pipe. It's pretty obvious, it's sort of like a kind of clarinet thing. The longer the tube, the lower the frequency and so on. But the tutors inside, embedded in that, they also have a multiple scattering effect, such that can then affect the local sounds in that cavity. And the better you can reduce the thing further, so it sounds a bit lower than what it should normally be, which is also useful thing. But the lower the sound, the longer the wavelength, the lower the frequency, the longer the wavelength, and the greater the propagating range. So, in other words, a system that might detect a submarine pump at 50 kilometers might now detect it at 100 kilometers, which is a good thing for a Navy guy to go to that. So that's the kind of thing. It's an interesting multiple scattering CR, and there are similar effects in solid state physics, where you've got basically electrons flowing, moving through crystal structures, and the effect of mass changes. And last thing, I'll talk a little bit about what Jeff kind of alluded to earlier on about how connection then to have. I did a bit of study on a thing called microconnector shorts. It's a kind of aquatic little bug, about the size of a grain of sand, sorry, a grain of coffee. And it's an aquatic insect, the kind of thing you see in, when you do primary study, you get pond life, as it were. These aquatic insects, and they swim to the surface, and they kind of, they've got little hairs on their bodies, and they kind of do a little kind of little somersault thing, and trap bubbles on their bodies, and then that allows them to breathe. So that's what they're doing before time. But what's interesting about the microconnector shorts thing, you can find out how size for size, it's the loudest animal on earth, would you believe? Very small, but it produces quite a large sound. In fact, you can actually hear them when you go past little lakes. They're in northern Europe sometimes. There's one there's a population in Leicestershire, I think, and also up in the Netherlands. And you can hear them as you walk by when the males want to mate. It's kind of about that kind of noise. The females love that sort of noise, they often migrate towards the males. And what it is basically, at the risk of causing all sorts of issues, if you Google singing penis, I kid you not, but make sure you put BBC on it, you'll find a bit more about that. But make sure you put BBC on it, otherwise it gets in. I can't be held responsible for what you might dig up when you Google that. But anyway, what happens is the males have this kind of barbed genitalia. This is all biology. We don't have to talk too much about that. But basically, they rub it down and it makes this noise. And what happens is that the animal behaves like a suit of armor, because it's an eco kind of sort of rattles about in its orgasmic kind of thrill. But because of the bubbles all around it, they then turn that. What would be essentially just a kind of sloshing field that doesn't radiate very well. Into a very strongly radiated, associated with the fact that the bubble drops start to resonate. We've put a paper out, myself and other colleagues at Strathclyde, on how this thing happens. Now, the point I'm making is that this is actually quite a useful thing from the point of view of sonar, because what you can then produce is these, what called very, albeit narrow band, but a very high. Very low frequency sources in a very compact thing. And it's a very efficient generation sound. You can easily make something rattle as you throw it, but it's very hard to make it produce sound that propagates far, because you have to what's called a law of falling velocity. In other words, you have to move water outwards to make that noise. But this thing, basically, you have something that rattles. This is the kind of thing you see on the bottom right, which is kind of like a cylindrical sort of aerosol sort of shape, and it has little bubbles inside, and it, as you throw it, it then produces these kind of noises, which are useful for various applications of seismic survey and other sort of naval applications. Now, the whole point about this is that we looked at the point of view of having multiple bands. More than one resonant tone. If you have one bubble, you only get one tone. But if you've got several, you can then get sort of funny indirection effects, which then provide you with a whole series of tones, which are not necessarily harmonically related. But what one thing you do see is you get a fundamental where essentially the total number of bubbles all kind of aggregate as one, effectively one bubble. But then, as you got higher in frequency, you then get different effects that you interact in a different way. And this is a kind of finite model. I have to say, I'm very lazy when it comes to being finite. I'm not a or a body, like Craig. But these are kind of like Minecraft versions of bubbles, cubes rather than spheres. But the really ought to be spheres. But never mind. Effectively, they work the same. So you can get these kind of affairs. This is a kind of multiple scattering effect, where you've got essentially the bubbles all kind of interact because they're very close to one another or in wavelength terms, and they're orientation that gives you different ways by which you can get these different types of tones generated. And I kind of did some analysis with it, going back to my atomic physics days, oh God, looking at two sets of scattering by molecules and things, and you can see at least the when you've got two bubbles, the lowest frequency behaves like one, and if you've got n bubbles, they behave like n. Then they start becoming much more complicated. So the multiple effect is you've got kind of an n scatter type problem. You've got essentially few number of bubbles in different orientations, different sizes, and the impact in different ways. And if you've got essentially an oscillating field which is much greater in wavelength, that then produces these kind of radiating fields which produce strong tones in the thing. So you can imagine if you told this sort of thing, there's kind of turbulence which produces oscillating field, but the bubbles then select the particular types of excitation and produce those radiating tones that you want. The likes of people like Tim Layton, who's much more the world expert on bubbles, he's been looking at non-spherical things as well, and I've been trying to take some of his ideas to account for that. Now, that then would affect it, because effectively then bubbles at different frequencies and behave in a slightly different way, and so you've got local interactions in the fact that you get interesting effects. But of course, you can't expect bubbles by themselves to be constrained in a system, particularly if you take it to see. So you have to look at things like how the coping's effective, so you can strain them. So like bubble wrap type thing, the bubbles behave in localized way, and you have to then do that pressure and that sort of thing. So it all becomes more complicated as time goes by. I'm running out. So, in terms of what kind of cartoons can it work? I don't know really. Certainly, all I can say is that multiple scattering phenomena is very important to sonar and acoustics in general. In terms of propagation, the types of devices that you might build into the test, and also, crucially, particularly with regards to the types of materials that you want to build and to play with. To some extent, I hope I'm not speaking to any of my colleagues out there. So it's kind of rested in his walls a little bit. They've done a lot of work on these weak scattering models and kind of simulated them and played with them and produced them. But they say the main emphasis has been looking at is the pressure and temperature dependence of the materials and the kind of voids that are produced and how they then change their character and their dynamics. But the actual multiple scattering phenomena has been, not that sophisticated. Weak scattering limits, you might be able to include like one or two little effects, but it's very much old hat to some extent. It's irritating people. But certainly now with the advent of metal materials and that sort of thing, there's a resurgence in that interest. And so things like, shame I couldn't be with you guys speaking today to talk a bit more detail about the kind of various ways that one might try and improve these things or adapt them for these kind of purposes. The way things have been going, certainly over the last decade or so, is that if you've got a problem in engineering, you throw a finite element analysis at it, and then you hope to kind of solve it. It kind of looks like a pretty picture that you obviously solved it because the manager looks at it and says, "Oh yeah, I recognize what that looks like, so you must have solved it." And as a fact, you end up basically just doing loads and loads of numerical experiments, and it'd be quite costly, and you don't get any physical impact. So that's why I think like few bonding patterns are kind of stuff that physicists have been looking at few body problems and that sort of thing. Might give us more, particularly with regards to things like the bubble thing around the rule of force thing. So if I had a Christmas, I still got my Christmas beard on. If I had this wish list, what would that, you know, if Santa Claus came along and said, what would you like? And so, well, clearly, I'd like a multiple scattering model that can do things like different non-spheric bits, spheroidal inclusions, and bottom layers, and that's what I'm doing. Although you've got random orientations are clearly useful, but maybe some that are not so random, you can then end up with or incorporate these ideas that the metamaterials concepts could then be incorporated in some sort of form. I've talked about a few scattering. Maybe it'll be that the techniques that are mainly time dependent, it has to be said, that are used for the 3D time calibrations, and that sort of thing, might then be in some way take account of some of the recent bumps, multiple scattering techniques to improve on their processing and physical understanding is crucial. I mean, I'm not an engineer, I admit. I'm a physicist, unfortunately, to my core. I'm very keen on things like physical understanding that you can try and explain things. So you have to be very careful what you can explain. I always remember the classic joke about the physicist experimenter comes in, shows a graph to a theoretician, he's got the A function that's a function compared with B, and he says, looks like A is greater than B. He said, oh, yeah, well, the theoretician says, yeah, that's very easy to explain, no problem with that. And he said, oh, no, I've got my graph upside down, B is actually greater than A. The theoretician says, oh, that's even easier to explain. So I should watch out for that sort of thing. But physical understanding is key to these things, despite the fact, AI and all these various things coming before. I'll kind of shy clear of that sort of thing. If you can understand what's going on, it's more than half the matter. Now, so finally, as they sorry to take your time, there's been the future Navy is going to have to do all sorts of things, working in all sorts of things. This is me talking to the admirals now. There's lots of various things and various things. But certainly, it needs innovation in its widest sense. So it's new approaches, new technologies, things. A reinvestigation of things that have been developed, like multiple scattering. So ships need to be stealthy, submarines, and survive, and so on. And basically, collaboration is really a key aspect to all of this. So that's why I'm pointing to you guys. So maybe we can talk about further in due course if you have a bit of chance to how we might refine things and improve things, so both ourselves and also interest funds for you guys, but also then ultimately for the admirals and the Navy and the matlabs that all the go off and on their wonderful ships around the world. So thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Thank you. Fantastic voice through the network. Problems that you have I should just say, because I wanted to reference that we had a nearly full hour to speak, which you used up. I should just say that David and I go back a long way, and 1980, I think it was, when we first started talking about politics, I was employed as a case student for my PhD.
That's right, yes.
Still exists, which is quite amazing. And over the years, I've had lots of the large F1 panels, and I'm doing the contact team. The Manchester Group have looked at super archive of the really hard problems and trying to translate those difficult problems into more clean problems that mathematicians can find benefits and then hopefully get some impact into the role I think we can play. In all the physicists, the engineers, both of them, and the mathematicians try and understand the phenomenon. Allowed to have a quick question or two from the audience, I think so.
Yeah, of course.
Hearing with some more. Would anyone like to ask a question today? Microphone.
I'd say it was a bit of a whistle stop tour. I should have focused maybe on one or two more specific things, but I tried to give people a flavour of the kind of things that might be of interest. So it's just the thought rather than necessarily. Just be careful what you Google. Thank you for your time, anyway, folks. As I say, I'd maybe like to talk a bit more about, you know, real maths when we get a chance. It's a shame I couldn't be with you physically. I had a bit of an accident over the weekend, so I'm getting better now. But anyway, thank you very much for your time, and I hope that maybe we can have further discussions in due course. And certainly, I hope to see you, Dave, and have a good trip to the magic time. And I hope that you all have a good conference and workshop in due course. Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, folks.